Hey, everybody, this is Alan Arnette with another podcast on the blog on alanarnette.com on Monday, July 26, 2021. And today we're talking about climbing in Pakistan's northern territories, the Karakoram Range, and the peaks K2 Broad Peak, Gasherbrum 1 and 2. There was activity down on Nanga Parbat, but that ended a few weeks ago with a Spanish team that cited mountain conditions and fatigue. And so that was the only expedition on Nanga this summer. And so now all the action is up north. Well, over the last 10 days, since the last time I gave an audio update, I've been doing daily, if not multiple daily blog posts on my blog at alanarnette.com. So, you know, if you want to hear the action on a daily basis, then always visit the site. Also, you can subscribe to my Facebook and Twitter feeds. And both of those are listed on the, you know, on the blog. But a lot has happened over the last 10 days, but also a lot didn't happen. We've seen summits, we've seen death, and we've seen bodies found on K2. So let's kind of walk through what's happened and also what's happening right now, again, on July 26th, with people going for the summit, even as we speak. And this is very personal for me because it was exactly 7 years ago today on July 27th, right now is 12:51 a.m. in Pakistan, that I was going to the summit from the high camp and summited on my birthday, my 58th birthday on July 27th, 2014. So this is a pretty special day to me, for me. And also, while it's still the 26th here in Colorado, tomorrow is the 27th, and I'll officially turn 65. So your podcast host here is officially on Medicare and an old man. So so with all of that, let's get into the Karakoram. When I say a lot didn't happen, that was primarily due to the weather. A couple of weekends ago, there was a big attempt over on Broad Peak. Several people made it, but it was a short weather window. But that weather kept everybody pretty much locked down on K2. A lot of people on K2 had gone to acclimatize up to Camp 2 and called it good if they were using supplemental oxygen. If they weren't, then they tried to go up and tag, you know, Camp 3, maybe a smidge above. But basically, everybody then retreated back down and all the action shifted over to Broad. So let's talk a little bit about that. It was a lot of people. It was estimated 50, 60 people that were all going to go up on the same day. A lot of that snow had accumulated on Broad Peak. And so led by Don Bowie, they were trying to go up, and Lolita, and they were trying to go up and summit it. And Loda Hinsta and Don Bowie both broke trail a lot by themselves, and then other people came up behind them to draft off of them. But in the end, the people that got this, route to the ropes to the top were the Pakistani rope fixing team from Karakoram Expeditions. So they got up there on July 18th, and that really opened the door for other teams to come up. And so Blue Sky Tours, they had a group go up, primarily the Korean team of Mr. Hongbin Kim. There was also people from the Polish team, the Beskid Expedition team, and again, from a Czech-Slovak team, that they also made it up, and Altitude team made it up of five climbers. So you can see all the names on my various blog posts, and you know, I'm terrible at pronouncing names, so I'm not even going to try all of these names, which are difficult for me, but I've got them all written down with the proper spelling on the website. But with that weekend, a lot of things happened. There were false starts. There were people that were going up and turned around. There were people that were on supplemental oxygen, people that weren't. There was really no clear leadership on the mountain. And, Don Bowie turned around because he got sick because of, you know, of drinking water that was contaminated with human waste by other climbers. So a lot of things were not going well on that weekend. People did summit. They came back down. And then trouble began on Broad Peak. First off, it started with Russian Anastasia Runova. She apparently fell into a crevasse, and fellow Russians or Ukrainians, Vitaly Laszlo, he executed a rescue with help from other people. But as he then later on began to describe, that a lot of people walked by and didn't offer any help, and they didn't use their radios to call down to base camp to try to summon help. Now, mind you, this was up on the summit ridge, which is a two-day climb from base camp for the strongest of climbers. But so there wasn't probably somebody that could get there, you know, on short notice, but still he found it troubling that a lot of people just kept walking by and not giving help. You know, that's beginning to be a big issue on these mountains, that the whole, you know, community and the fellowship of fellow climbers helping each other seems to be disappearing as a value amongst mountaineers. And I tend to believe that's because of the new people to the sport, the inexperienced people, and that's causing people to really think that it's all about themselves and the mountain, when in reality, it has to do with a lot more than that. So hats off to all the people that jumped in to rescue Anastasia. But then also something really horrible happened, and that is that Mr. Kim, that he fell also, and he fell apparently on the north side, on the Chinese side. And when Mr. Kim fell in, again, Vitaly went over to try to help him. And as he writes, he fell into a crevasse, and he went down, Vitaly went down 5 meters, 15 feet. And, but Mr. Kim was down 15 meters, 45 feet. And they were trying to get him out. And apparently he says that he tried to shift his Jumar, and it disengaged, slipped, who knows really what happened, but Mr. Kim fell to his death. Just horrible, horribly tragic. Because if you don't know who Mr. Kim is, he made a name for himself by climbing all 13 of the 8,000 meter mountains after losing all 10 fingers to frostbite on Denali in 1991. So this Korean climber, just unbelievably strong. You know, he summited now all 14 of the 8,000 meters mountains without having any fingers. He was with a group of other Koreans here on Broad Peak. It's unclear as to what role they played in trying to rescue him. We've heard nothing from the Korean team, no statements about, you know, what happened, but apparently he did fall on the Chinese side. You know, when you're coming down from the summit on Broad Peak, is a very narrow, steep ridge. And if the weather is really bad, it's easily to get disoriented. And it's happened before that people have taken the wrong turn and gone down the Chinese side instead of the Pakistan side. And the Chinese side, to my knowledge, no one's ever summited from that side. I could be wrong on that, but it's very, very steep, very technical, very dangerous as compared to the Pakistani side, which is considered to be the normal route. The Pakistan military did dispatch a helicopter with the unprecedented support and permission from the Chinese to fly a Pakistan military helicopter in the Chinese airspace. So kudos to the Korean government, the Chinese and Pakistan for working together. However, the helicopter never made it over the ridge because of weather. So as of now, Mr. Kim is presumed dead in that deep crevasse. And my condolences go out to his friends and family and teammates for just a tragic loss to the Korean climbing community and the worldwide climbing community in general. So that was Broad Peak. Also, during that time, there were some summits over on the Gasherbrums. Again, on Gasherbrum II, there were Iranian mountaineers, Armin Shapri and Milan, I won't even pronounce his last name, K-E-S-H-A-V-A-R-Z-I. Anyway, you can try to play for that one at home. Anyway, so they both, two Iranian climbers, both summits, so good on them. Congratulations. Also, again, a handful of Pakistani climbers. Again, these Pakistanis really are making a name for themselves by climbing multiple 8,000 meter mountains. Sirbaz made it, he had his eighth 8,000 meter mountain. He has now Everest K2, Nanga, Lhotse, Broad Peak, Manaslu, and Annapurna. So these are becoming very strong world-class climbers directly out of Pakistan, climbing for themselves, not in support of overseas clients. Also, the Czech-Slovak team put a handful of people on top. And also the altitude team had, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people on top. They did really well. So a lot of success over on G2. In general, G2, along with Choyo-Yu and Manaslu, are considered the three most achievable of the 14 8,000 meter mountains. So that takes us back to K2, you know, the weather hits. So everybody gone up, I said, to C3, maybe C2, three. They were acclimatized. They were just waiting for the weather window. The big winds and snow came in over on the West Ridge. Graham and Ian, they had tried to go up and they kind of got lost on the bottom of the mountain of the ridge, trying to find the right route. They eventually figured it out, but then the weather hits. So they retreated and hunkered down in base camp, in their base camp for a while. And now they headed back up. The last report was that they hit 6,900 meters, which is far short of the summit of K2 at 8,600 meters. And their tracker showed them descending, but it's unclear on exactly what those details are. But those two guys are incredibly strong, and I'm sure they're going to do it their best, and we'll get more information as it becomes available. So that takes us over on K2. And right now there's a handful of teams up there. And right now they are climbing, even as I'm recording this at 2 o'clock on Monday, July 26th, 1 a.m. Tuesday, July 27th in Pakistan. Pioneer Adventures out in Nepal is supporting two Ukrainian teams and a handful of other people. And they have Sherpas that have come up, and they've been instrumental in fixing the route thus far, along with American company Madison Mountaineering, Garrett Madison, my good friend. You've seen my interviews with him recently. And so Pioneer will probably summit this morning, assuming everything goes well. That'll be on the 27th. Garrett's looking at going up the next day on the 28th. Garrett has two other people with him, Kenton Cool with a client and John Gupta with a client. So, it should be between Pioneer and Madison around 50 people that are going to summit over the next 2 days. Now, there's also a lot of small teams that are on K2 that are not associated with either Garrett or Pioneer, Mingma's team. And they, they're pretty much on their own, but they will probably draft off the larger team's work, use their boot pass and use their ropes, and also summit. Some of them are actually going up tonight. Some of the individual Pakistani small teams, some will go up tomorrow. It's a lot of action going on up there. One thing that is also been a news breaker is that 2 days ago, there was a death on an unclimbed part of K2, and it was going up, expected to be a new route on the southeast face, climbed by Scottish legend Rick Allen, along with Austrian Stephen Keck and Spaniard Jorge Tosas. And so they were climbing up it. It's unclear exactly how high they got, but an avalanche hit them. It was probably a small avalanche as opposed to a big, massive one that we often see. But even a small avalanche can knock you off your feet, knock you into a crevasse or off of the edge of a ledge. Sadly, tragically, Rick Allen, at around age 68, has died on the mountain. His body was recovered. Stefan and Jorde were both long-lined, basically a helicopter, again, a Pakistani military helicopter, came and long-lined them off the mountain, where they drop a rope down from the helicopter. They tie it in with their harnesses, clip it in, and they take them back down to base camp. It's really a tragic loss to the Scottish, the British, UK climbing community worldwide. Rick was a legend. He and Sandy Allen made the name for themselves amongst other major feats by climbing an unclimbed ridge on Nanga Parbat. They spent a week on that ridge above 8,000 meters for the entire week, and summited. Just amazing capability, physical capability. In 2018, Rick Allen was over on Broad Peak trying to do a solo ascent at the age of mid 60s, 65, 66, and got lost in the bad conditions, bad visibility. His body was spotted by a drone, and a rescue team went up and it was helped bring him down. So this guy has seen a lot. And so I'm sure when he heard that avalanche coming, it must have just been a moment. And I can only imagine. So my condolences go out to Rick's friends, families, teammates, everybody around the world that knew him and admired his feats and were inspired by what he did. Just absolutely tragic. So the last couple of days, there's been route fixing on K2 going from Camp 3 to Camp 4. apparently that crevasse that was an issue back last winter, that the teams there, it stopped some people. The, as I call them, the K2-9 that ended up making the first K2 summit were able to go around it. And talking to Garrett a couple of weeks ago, he thought that maybe snow had filled it in, so it wasn't as major of a hazard. Haven't heard any updates on it, but apparently it's not enough to cause people to stop the progress, because teams have already made it to Camp 4. That's the high camp. And they were fixing the line up to the bottleneck when they came upon the bodies of the three climbers that disappeared last year, or I should say in January, February 5th, actually, on K2 during the winter attempt. They found their bodies. This was something that was an open item. So Pakistani Ali Sadpara, Icelander John Snorri, and Chilean Juan Pablo Mohr Prieto, all three disappeared. They had gone up from Camp 4 along with Ali's son, Sahid, and Sahid's regulator developed a problem. Again, this is early February 2021. And his father told his son to go down and wait for them at Camp 4 after they were going to summit, then come back down and meet him. Well, they never appeared. They never returned. Sahid tried his best to look for them without the benefit of his oxygen. He stayed up there for two nights, calling out, searching with headlamps, looking for headlamps, and eventually, for his own safety and survival, returned to base camp. The Pakistani military did dispatch a jet with infrared camera technology to search the area, but they didn't find anything. So Sahid decided he was going to go back in the summer with a small team and look for his father and his teammates. And they did go up, they did come back, and they've been there for the last 3 or 4 weeks of this season. They did go up to around just below Camp 4, used a drone to look, to search in that area without finding anything. So now the rope fixers were going up and fixing around the bottleneck, and they found the three bodies around 300 to 400 meters just below and above, below the bottleneck and above the high camp. So, you know, exactly what happened is still to be determined. If they summited, is still to be determined. And all of that will come in due course. But now is the time, I believe, to give the family space to grieve, to have closure. And so I know it's got to be a moment of bittersweet, that they're happy they know that their loved ones, you know, where they are, but also the fact that they're no longer with them is incredibly tragic. As to whether their bodies will be removed or buried on the mountain, that's strictly a family decision, and that's not for the public to decide on or to contemplate, in my opinion. So, Mike, again, my condolences go out to Ali, John, and Juan Pablo's family for what they're going through right now, intense grief at this moment. So with that as a backdrop, you have now the two teams of Pioneer and Madison heading up. Pioneer tonight, Madison tomorrow. The third major team, Karakoram Expeditions, they were the major force over on Broad Peak a weekend ago, and you know, that was a difficult time. There was a lot of questions about the coordination and things that were going on the mountain, and so now they were headed up. In fact, they had team members, clients as high as Camp 2 on K2, and they made the decision to cancel the entire expedition. They cited lack of cooperation with other teams, snow conditions, but probably most importantly was the just being gutted by Rick Allen's death. Totally understandable. But the other teams are going up, and they've decided not to. So I think there's at least some questions open as to their organization. They did say that they lost a lot of supplies and tents up at the high camps due to wind. That also happened to some of the other teams, but they're obviously able to somehow or another compensate for it. So that's where we are. A lot of action in the Karakoram. Just quickly over on Gasherbrum I, Marco's team, he's got a handful of people trying to make a ascent on G1. They would be the first ascent this season. Supposedly, there's a couple other people that want to try to do G1, G2. Unclear if they're going to try to do G2 or not, because it's now getting late into the season. This weekend, or this today, the early this week on July 26th, 27th, there's a group of about 20 climbers over on Broad Peak that are still trying to get up that were thwarted on the first attempt. Supposedly there's an individual, Sarah, from the United States, who wants to ski down from the top of Broad Peak. And if she did that, that'd be be kind of fun to watch, wouldn't it? Sort of like a couple of years ago, watching him ski down from the top of K2. That was amazing. So a lot of action still going on in the Karakoram here, especially over the next 48 hours. And we'll see some more action probably over on the Gasherbrums and Broad Peak this week as well. But for now, all eyes are on K2 and the team's going up. And we obviously wish them all a safe climb and a safe summit and get back home to their families with all their fingers and toes safely. All right. That's all for now. I'll be posting regular updates on my blog at alanarnett.com. So if you don't hear another update on YouTube or on the podcast, then make sure you check on that on a regular basis, because I am updating that multiple times a day right now during the summit pushes. All right, climb on. This is Alan. And remember, memories are everything.